Welcome to the Oaks Church. My name is Terry Lee Kirkland. I'm one of the pastors here. If we haven't had the opportunity to meet yet, it's great to see you this morning. Whether you call the Oaks home or you're a first-time guest, we are so glad that you are here with us this morning. We're in a series right now called Stories, where we've just kind of been looking at different stories throughout Scripture for the summer. So if you have a Bible, go ahead and find Jeremiah 29. That's where we're going to be this morning. If you don't have a copy of Scripture, that's okay. It's going to be on the screens beside me. And we also have several copies of God's Word that we would love for you to grab as you leave today, just as our gift to you so that you can connect with God throughout the week by reading Scripture. One quick thing before we dive into the sermon for this morning, I just wanted to plug our MC leader training. That's our missional community leader training. So you may be thinking, well, I don't know if I could lead a missional community or not. That's why we have training, okay? So whether you are just kind of considering it or thinking about it or have some questions, we would love for you to come and join our training this afternoon at 12, directly after our gathering. You can kind of see how we work people through the process, come to training, you're an apprentice for a semester or for a year, and then you lead your own missional community. We talk every week about making disciples, and this is one of the primary ways that we do this at the Oaks Church. So I'd love for you to be a part of that today so that we can help work you into that pipeline, develop you as a leader so that you can lead people. Why am I talking about that this morning? It's because we have grown a ton over the summer. We're growing a lot. Yeah, this is God's grace in our church, right? We're beginning to grow a lot already in the fall, and we have a surplus of people for the amount of missional communities we have at the moment, all right? So you're going to be very close to people in the fall in your missional community, but we're hoping to start some more in the spring or even next fall. So that's why we're doing that. Now, we're going to be studying Jeremiah 29, where there's this beautiful promise, right, that so many of us know. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare or your prosperity. Plans for your peace and not for evil. We're going to be talking about future plans this morning. And as I was looking at this passage, studying it this week, I was reminded of a time that I made a lot of future plans. It was senior year of high school, right? Last year was our 10-year reunion. We didn't make it back down to Florida for our 10-year high school reunion, but just the thought of my plans as an 18-year-old were embarrassing enough to wish that I could just kind of lock a lot of those memories away. Unfortunately, one of the assignments we were given senior year was to write a letter to our future selves of all the grand plans that we had, what we thought our lives would look like in 10 years. Now, the only thing that that letter does to this day is serve as evidence that I have a complete inability to predict my future. I'm pretty sure whenever I read that letter now, the only thing I got right was my name. Like, nothing looks the same. And if you think back to maybe some plans that you've had in the past and look to where God has brought you today, it has made one thing evidently clear. You are not God. And you do not know your future. But with wisdom, right, maybe the desires we have, we try to come up with our future plans, don't we? And how do we make those plans? Our future plans are so often based upon our greatest perceived need at the time. Well, let me tell you what I mean by that. If your greatest perceived need right there as you sit in that chair is more money, right? It's financial wealth, then your future plans will be based upon get a good education, land a good job, make good money, right? If your future perceived need is this, it will direct your future plans. If your greatest perceived need in this moment is a spouse, then your future plans will be directed by dating, engagement, wedding, right? If your greatest perceived need in this moment is a better self-image, then your future plans will be directed by getting a gym membership, by getting a new wardrobe, maybe by a motivational podcast, right? Like whatever you need to fix this greatest perceived need will be a part of your future plan. Now, I'm not knocking the desire to provide for yourself financially. I'm not knocking the desire to get married, right? I love marriage. I'm not knocking the desire to feel good about yourself. These are good things in themselves. But what if they are not your greatest perceived need? What would happen if your perception of what you need in this moment is off? Just a little bit. What if something that may be good has become your greatest perceived need? What would happen to your life? Well, I think we look at Jeremiah 29 and we see what happens when a perceived need becomes your greatest perceived need wrongly placed. We look at the people of Israel here in Jeremiah 29, and we see that they sought their greatest perceived need as political rest. They thought their greatest perceived need was perhaps abundant crops or financial stability or military power. And what happened? They sought those things at the expense of their true need, God Himself. And so whenever we look at Jeremiah 29, we see that God loved His people so much that He would discipline them to restore His relationship with them. That God would love His people so much that the kingdom of Jerusalem would be laid to waste so that one day God could welcome them into a better one. You see, if we misunderstand our greatest perceived needs, we will find ourselves in the same place that Israel was. But if we see our greatest perceived need is God Himself, then our future plans will be based upon hope in God alone. Last week we looked at what it meant to live as followers of Christ, seeking the peace of the city in the presence of God. If we kind of summarize the first 14 verses of Jeremiah 29, that's what we would say. We talked about what it meant to seek the peace of the city by investing in those around you, by inviting other people to follow Jesus, and by interceding in prayer on their behalf, right? We're going to be a church that seeks the peace of the city. We're going to look at the other half of that today, what it means to seek the presence of God. And it's my hope that your future plans will be based upon the fact that your greatest need this morning, despite whatever else is going on in your life, is the presence of God. As we look at verses 10 through 14, I want you to see that our hope for the future is based upon God's presence in the present. Our hope for the future is completely and totally based upon God's presence right now, this morning. You may be here this morning and you're not even, you wouldn't even consider yourself religious. You're not a Christian. Maybe you don't know where you're at in your faith. So maybe you're wondering, how will this apply to me? Well, what I want you to just quickly examine perhaps is how many times you've made mistakes in directing your future. How many times you've misjudged your needs and had a couple regrets looking backward. If that is the case, I'm just going to try to create an opportunity this morning for God to reveal Himself to you as your greatest need. If you're a believer here this morning, you may be tempted to check out right now, right? Oh, I need God's presence. Yes, right? Me and God are good. I've trusted in Christ. What I would ask you this morning is, do you still see God's presence as your highest priority? Or are you tempted this morning to think, that box is checked, what I really need to focus on is X, Y, or Z? You see, so often I see believers, and I'm even tempted myself, to run to the leftovers that this world offers whenever we are invited to the table of God, seated in His presence and enjoying His glory. And I want to call you back to that this morning, that we would be people who fervently seek the presence of God. And so that's what I desire to do as we look at Jeremiah 29. If you have a copy of God's word, pick up with me in verse 10. We'll read along. This is a letter from Jeremiah. He says, "For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. This is the word of the Lord. What I want you to see in verses 10 through 14 here is that our greatest need is the presence of God. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at these four verses in this context. After we go through those, we're going to just kind of say, okay, where are we basing our future upon because of what we have learned from this passage? Three things, and then we'll be done for the day. Now, what do we see in verse 10? That God gives a promise to bring his people back to this place. So you're carried off into exile, into captivity, right? After your nation has been conquered by Babylon, a greater nation, and then you get this promise. Thus says the Lord, I will bring you back, right? This is great news. And yet God says it will be 70 years before this promise is fulfilled. This is a part of God's graciously drawing Israel back to himself. It would be 70 years that they were in a culture in which they didn't know the language and they weren't in control. It would be 70 years. Think about that right now, right? That would be like God saying, hey, you may be a prisoner of war right now, but in 2090, you're going to be set free. Some of you guys are doing the math. You're like, yeah, I don't think anything's going to affect me in 2090, right? May not be around for that. But what is God doing? Even in this, we see his love toward Israel. Don't let this question God's love for Israel. Don't let this make you question it for one second. You see, God's desire for Israel is that they would learn he is completely sufficient, that his presence was their greatest need. And with God as their subject and Babylon as their classroom, they would spend 70 years learning this truth. You see, at this time period, Israel experienced lavish wealth, right? Great houses, great living, had everything they want. But in their lavish lifestyle, they were still spiritually bankrupt. And what God would say over and over again is from an eternal perspective, it is much greater to be physically poor and to be spiritually rich. And what we see here is that God was redirecting their hearts to turn back to him. You see, God promises to visit his people after 70 years in exile. Now, as we look forward through the pages of Scripture, we see that God was faithful to keep this promise. That's what I love about Scripture, is that we're able to look back through the history of its pages and see that 70 years would pass, and God would raise up another king in another land called Persia. And Persia would conquer Babylon, and now with Persia in control of Israel, King Cyrus would let Israel return to their land, rebuild their temple, rebuild the wall. Unlike King Nebuchadnezzar, who would take people out of their land, King Cyrus would put people in it so that he could earn their favor. And we see that this was a direct fulfillment of God's prophecy. In Ezra 1, you can read about it. It says, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that whoever is among you of all his people, may his God be with him and let him go up to Jerusalem. God promised that he would bring his people back, and he did. Now, why would I show you that in another text this morning? Because what you need to understand is that God is always at work, even when you can't see it. Imagine that you're an Israelite in that moment as God is working out the backstory that you are completely unaware of, right? While Israel was in captivity, there were two people who got married. They had a son. They named him Cyrus. They thought it was a great name for this young child. He began to grow up, was a strong leader, right? Even from a young age, He would be placed on the throne. He would have great political power and leadership. He would raise up a military. He would conquer other kingdoms. He would conquer the kingdom of Babylon and then liberate Israel. That took place over the 70 years that Israel was in captivity. And I am prone to think that some people, while they were in Israel, felt like their prayers weren't being answered. Felt like God was slow to hear them. And what they couldn't see is that God's plan was at work over the span of time in another place. God is not slow to fulfill his promises. Your prayers are not unanswered. You can trust God's timing. Some of you may be in here this morning so nervous about the future that you can barely hear the words I'm saying. Some of you right now are homesick and wish that you're having lunch with people after church today that you haven't seen in a long time. Some of you are struggling with a conversation or an argument that you had with someone earlier this week. I don't know what in your life perhaps makes you question God's plan. But you can know this, God is working it out for your good. You see, most of the people that read this letter read it in Babylon and would wait and watch it to come to pass from the windows of heaven. And yet, because God is good, we know that they are better for it. And God gives a promise in verse 11, right? For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. See, one of the greatest problems that we have whenever we come to this passage or perhaps any text in the Bible is we read you and we just immediately want to put our first names there, right? For I know the plans that I have for Terry Lee, plans for prosperity, right? And while there are applications and principles that we can pull from a passage like this, we need to first understand the context it was written in. This was written to the people of God. This was written with God's definition of welfare and prosperity, not our 21st century definition of wealth and prosperity. So whenever God says to them, I have plans for you all, for you as the people of God, for your welfare, we see that fulfilled whenever he brings the people back to the land where his presence would be. We see that this is fully fulfilled in the New Testament, where God's presence would be fully known, not in going back to a land, but in the coming of a person, Jesus Christ. See, God was at work through every single bit of this to bring apart his plan of peace. Then he promises in verses 12 and 13, you will call upon me and come and pray to me, I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. God says, if you seek me wholeheartedly, I will be found. What an amazing promise for us this morning. Now, whenever we see that whole heart, some of us may think, I can't seek God perfectly. I don't know how. We need to see two things. One, that when we trust in Christ, God gives us a new heart. And second, that God does not require perfection here. He requires a single devotion. What he wanted was Israel's complete allegiance to him. He wanted their worship, not their half-hearted worship. He wanted them to seek him with their whole heart. And he would be found. See, God was not hiding from the people of Israel. He says, if you seek me, you will find me. I was looking at this passage this week and was just kind of reminded of when me and Brooks, my two-year-old son, play hide-and-seek, right? We play hide-and-seek in the living room or in the basement, wherever. Now, if you were to watch me play hide-and-seek with my son, you would think to yourself, he doesn't understand the game, right? He is the absolute worst hider ever. Because he goes and hides behind the couch, and literally both of his legs are hanging out. He peeks behind the curtain, and you can see half of his face, right? What is my intention in that moment? It is to enjoy my son and for him to enjoy me. I am not hiding to stay hidden. I'm hiding in that moment to ultimately be found. Whenever the people of God here may feel some semblance of the removal of God's presence, it was ultimately so that he would be found through the words of the prophet, through the actions of the kings, through the restoration of Jerusalem, and that they would find him and know him when they sought him with their whole hearts. He would restore their fortunes, as verse 14 says, and gather his people to Israel. And when we look at this passage, we see that our greatest future hope is found in the presence of God. We look at the context of these four verses and also realize that God's word doesn't have an expiration date. So there is truth for us here this morning that shapes the way that we live this week. If our future hope is based upon God's presence in the present, then I think we need three proofs of our future hope, and I want to give them to you this morning. The first thing we see in this passage is that we have a future hope in God's promises. You see, God made promise after promise to Israel. Even in this passage, right? Seek the welfare of the city and you will find your welfare. I will return you after 70 years. Seek me and you will find me. Call out to me and I will hear you. Why does God go to such great lengths to make his promises known to his people? Particularly his future promises known to his people, as he does right here in Jeremiah 29. Why? I think it's because our typical response to thinking about the future is a sinful one. You see, I think that we often think about the future, and our response is one of two things. One, we're overcome with anxiety, right? We get nervous, we get anxious, we get worried. We don't know what tomorrow holds, so we're nervous. That's option one. Two, we're confident, right? Look at my GPA. Look at what everyone around me is saying. Read this reference letter. My future is paved in gold. I am good to go. We often think about our future and our response is crippling fear or complete overconfidence. John Calvin would write about this, saying that these are two extremes of evil. He says, for the world labors under two extreme evils. They sink in despair or are too much exalted by foolish pride. For when they devise vain hopes for themselves, they are immediately wrapped up above the clouds, fly here and there, and in short, they think they can climb into heaven. This is the excess of vain and foolish confidence. But when they are dejected, then they fall down wholly frightened, nay, being astonished and lifeless. They lose every feeling, receive no comfort, and cannot taste of anything which God promises. When you think about the future, what is your response? Is it complete fear? If that's the case, then you have forgotten the promises of God, or perhaps haven't familiarized yourself with them in the first place. If it's complete overconfidence, you need to be reminded that the only sure things are the things that have been said by God alone. So what does it mean to have our future built upon God's promises and not ourselves? This only comes whenever we store the word of God up in our hearts. You see, the most comforting part of Jeremiah 29 is not verse 11 to me, but whenever we read in verse 10, for thus says the Lord. That's a promise. When you read in the pages of Scripture, for thus says the Lord, you say, I can build my life on that. When you read in the pages of Scripture, for thus says the Lord, regardless of tomorrow's diagnosis, conversation, or person's view of you, you can build your life upon that truth. And what does this mean for us this morning? It means we cling to the promises. In verse 12, we read that if we call upon the Lord, he will hear us. That if we cry out to the Lord, he is near. We cling to the promise that if we have confessed our sins and trusted in Christ, they are completely forgiven and are removed from us as far as the east is from the west. They have been sunk into a bottomless ocean to be brought up never again. It means that no matter how slow your growth in the faith may feel this morning, that God will finish the work that he began in you. It means as a young church, we cling to the promise that Jesus made in Matthew 16. I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I guarantee you that if my senior letter would have been full of these promises, it would have been more worthy of a picture frame than a trash can. Build your life on these promises. Direct your future on these promises. Because these promises are a sign of God's presence. You see, the specific future promise and source of hope for Israel is that they would once again return to the kingdom of Israel. But the hope of those who have trusted in Christ is that we would be welcomed into a greater kingdom with a greater king. That whenever we see Christ face to face and we are under his rule in his presence, suffering would be a distant memory and we would wrestle with sin no more. We are a people who cling to the promises of God as those in Jeremiah did. Now, what are some barriers to believing in God's promises? I want to be quick here because I do think we have some. First, I think we're extremely impatient people. Right? I'll be the first to admit I'm not a patient person. Right? We like two-day shipping. Most of our meals are microwaved, and we can't stand waiting at red lights. And what do the promises of God mean? It requires your patience to trust in God's timing and see their fulfillment. That's problem one. I think our second problem is we have trust issues. Right? Can we admit that? Everything always sounds too good to be true. Vegan hot dogs are a thing, as if hot dogs weren't bad enough. There are vegan ones, right? We're like, how could this be? We see someone's abs on Instagram, and we're like, they're Photoshopped, right? We can't believe anything. We put the best promises on some kind of like probationary period, not wanting to really believe them. And what we need to know is that whenever God speaks through his word, it is worthy of our trust completely. So we are people who are basing our future hope on the promises of God. The second proof of our future hope is future hope in God's plans. You see, Israel had big plans. Part of the reason that Israel was currently in this mess, taken captive into Babylon, is because their king, King Zedekiah at the time, had big plans. Right, so what happened is King Nebuchadnezzar started pressuring Israel. So they said, hey, we'll just kind of be a part of Babylon in that we'll serve under you and let you kind of be the main boss. And so King Zedekiah did that for a while. And he was like, all right, I'll answer to King Nebuchadnezzar, kind of get my own thing going on. And then finally he got tired of it, right? He wanted to be in control. And so what King Zedekiah did is he made a treaty with Egypt saying, let's revolt and overthrow Babylon. What happened is Egypt didn't show up. So King Zedekiah kind of put his neck out. King Nebuchadnezzar gets bad that he tried to stage this revolt and overthrow them. And so then he just kind of takes Israel completely into captivity. We have plans. Israel had plans to build houses and plant gardens. Not in Babylon, in Israel. And yet what we see here in this passage is that God was ultimately working out his plan, not Israel's and not King Zedekiah's. We need to be reminded that it is okay to not know God's plans and still cling to verse 11, that God knows his plans for us. And he declares that his plans are good and for our welfare. This is called the providence of God. Charles Spurgeon speaks of it in this way. He said, we dare not profess to understand the ways of God to man. They are past finding out. Providence is a great deep. Its breadth exceeds the range of our vision, and its depth baffles our profoundest thought. We need to be reminded of God's providence, because our lives will go best when we understand our place in the providence of God. We so much worry about our future plans, misunderstanding where we belong in the providence of God. Let me give you an example. Let's say I was to board an airplane this afternoon. Now, if I was to get on that plane and the stewardess escorted me into the cockpit of that plane, put me in the pilot seat and said, hey, you're good to go, and closed the door, I would be absolutely terrified. Why? Because I can't navigate an airplane. I don't know how to radio control tower, and I sure can't land this thing safely, right? If I was sitting right there, I would be mortified knowing that I do not deserve to be there in that place. But whenever I get on an airplane, you know what happens? I look at my ticket and I see that my place is 13C or 19A, and I go and sit exactly where I was designed to be. And I'm able to rest my eyes or read a book, but the one thing I don't have to worry about is where we're going. Whenever we know our place in the providence of God, we can trust that we are exactly where we need to be and that God is in complete control and he is exactly where he needs to be. This is the promise of Jeremiah 29:11, that you can trust the providence of God is for your good even when you don't see it. Some New Testament scholars have said that Romans 8:28 is kind of like a mirror passage of Jeremiah 29:11. Romans 8:28, some of you guys may know it. I want to read 28 and 29. It says, "We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among the brothers." Why do we need to read both verses there? Because I think reading verse 29 keeps us from imposing our definition of good on that passage. We read verses 28 and 29. We read that God works all things out for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And then in 29, we see that the thing God is working out is that we would ultimately be conformed to the image and character of Jesus Christ. That is the highest good that God can bring you, is to look more and more like Jesus as you are forced to depend and trust on Jesus. That's God's plan for your life. You see, for God, he is good, completely good. Everything he does is good. And so for God to ever work something out, despite how it feels in the moment, in a way that is not ultimately good, would be a contradiction of his character. And that is an illogical possibility. God cannot contradict who he is. And so he is always working for your good. So in the moment, you may wonder how something is working out for your good. But because of who God is, you never have to wonder if something is working out for your good. This is the great hope we have as believers, that we could look at something even as horrific as the crucifixion of Christ and see that by God's grace, that terrible moment was his plan for bringing the greatest thing that would ever happen to humanity. God is always working his plans out for our good. This means that your unfulfilled dreams do not define you. This means that you can replace your anxiety and worry with steadfast trust for God, knowing that his plans are good. And we often say, if I just knew the will of God in my life, if I just knew God's plan, things would be so much easier. I want to clear that up for you. 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification." So many things haven't been revealed to us. And what I would say to you is don't worry about the things that God hasn't revealed. But the things that God has revealed, pursue them. God has said clearly that growth happens in a body of believers called the church. So join one. If not this one, join another one where you can connect and grow and be known. God has said clearly that the natural response to an inward belief in Christ is an outward expression of baptism. Have you done that? Are you serving joyfully? Are you giving generously? Where God has said, "My will for you is that you would grow in the things that I have laid before you, that you would be obedient." Are you faithful in those plans that God has for you? Or would you see those plans laid out before you and say, "Nah, I'm going to ignore those, but I want to know the 5-year plan for my life." You see, our future hope is in the presence of God, and we trust him to see it through. Third and finally, the third proof of our future hope is future hope in God's presence. You see, the theme of God's presence runs from cover to cover in Scripture. We see the story begin with God present in his creation, walking with Adam and Eve in the garden. The story closes in Revelation, where we see that the presence And the dwelling place of God is with man forever. The presence of God is all throughout Scripture. And yet what Jeremiah 29 reminds us is that the consequence of sin is the separation from God's presence. See, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, they were removed from the presence of God and cast out of the garden. When Jeremiah writes to the Israelites, they had spurned God's commands and were removed from the place of the temple where God's manifest presence was said to dwell. And that matters for us this morning because whenever we read Isaiah, we see that our sin has separated us from God too. Your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. If our greatest need, not just our greatest perceived need, but if our greatest need is the presence of God, and yet we read Isaiah 59:2 and see that our sins have created a separation from God's presence, then we have a great problem on our hands because we have been separated from our greatest need, which is God himself. How would we be reconciled again? If our sin has separated us from God, how could we enter a relationship again? There would need to be one who is both God and man to fully mediate between us. There would have to be one who would take flesh upon himself and obey God's commands every single place that we have failed. There would have to be one who would absorb the just punishment and wrath of God that we deserved. There would have to be one that would fully pay the debt of sin, which is death, and yet take up his life again. And he came. He is the great I am. His name is Jesus Christ. You see, the fulfillment of these promises would not be in returning to a place, but in the coming of a person. In Daniel chapter 9, we read that Daniel, as one of the exiles spoken of here in Jeremiah 29, that he would have a prophecy given from the Lord, that he would know that they would be entering into the presence of God again by returning to the land, but that there would be a greater day of God's presence with his people. He was given a number, not 70, but 70 times 7, 490 years until the people of God would really understand the presence of God. And 490 years after the people stepped foot again in Jerusalem, Jesus would begin his ministry. The presence of God would be fully on display as John the Baptist would proclaim to every person with an earshot, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." The presence of God would be known in the person of Christ. We come here this morning admitting that our greatest need is the presence of God, that our only future hope is God's presence in our present state, and realize that Jesus is the manifest presence of God who has come to restore our relationship with him. You see, every week we take the Lord's Supper, and we talk about the new covenant that has come in Christ. And Jeremiah, just chapters later from this, would write about the new covenant that would one day come and be fulfilled in the Messiah. He said, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel, with the people of Judah. This is the covenant that I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more." You see, every week when we take that cup, we celebrate the fact that we have been welcomed into this relationship as new covenant people who have their sins forgiven and the law of God written on their hearts through the work of the Holy Spirit and the finished work of Christ. This changes everything about us. Three final ways we apply this. God's presence is based upon knowing Jesus. Do you know Jesus? God's presence is based upon knowing Jesus. You may be here this morning, you're like, "I don't feel God's presence." Let me encourage you. God's presence is not based upon how you feel in the moment. It's based upon the finished work of Christ. So if you've trusted in him, you are forgiven and near to God. If you haven't taken that step, do it today by saying, "God, I realize I'm a sinner and I need Jesus to be right with you." Second, God's presence is promised when we live on mission with him. Every week we talk about every member being a missionary, that we would live on mission with God. One of these great promises of God's presence comes after the Great Commission. Whenever Jesus tells us to go and make disciples, and then he says, "Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." See, God would make his presence known in Jeremiah by restoring his people and gathering them back to himself. And now God makes his presence known by sending us out to tell others about him. Third and finally, God's presence provides all we need. In Psalm 16:11, we read, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore." See, we are a people that, because of this truth, believe that our only future hope is God's presence in the present. So join me in shredding those senior letters, because God has far bigger plans. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we are grateful that you speak to us. God, that we know you in Christ. Lord, that we know you through your word. Lord, as we look at this passage and just the various things that you have revealed to us, I pray that you would teach us how to respond. Holy Spirit, teach us how to respond to this word. That we would be changed by it, that we would be refreshed by it, that we would be challenged by it. Lord, for those here this morning who don't know you, I pray in this moment that they would realize that their greatest need is to have a relationship with you. God, that they would pray in this moment, admitting that they are a sinner and that they need you. They need to trust in Christ, in his death and in his resurrection, that they may have life in his name. Lord, for those of us here that are believers, I pray that you would press this text into our hearts and that we would be able to discern what is the next step in obedience. What is the next step that we need to take to respond to your word? We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.